So Spider-Man Across the Spider-Verse is the sequel movie into Spider-Man Into the Spider-Verse, which was actually the first movie that I ever reviewed on my channel.
Nobody cares!
Which, it's funny how my channel kind of feels like it always comes full circle, and I always just thought that this was going to be a fantastic review. Before I get into this review, the theater that I went to gave me this really cool looking poster, so let me go ahead and check this out. And can you guys see that? I mean, there's going to be some glare from my light, but yeah. But I mean, that's a pretty dope poster, right? Now that I got that out the way, now into the official review. So going into this movie, I was wondering if this movie could hit the same level of just spectacularness that the first movie had hit. I mean, it was really very surprising that the first movie was as good as it was. I remember going into the first Spider-Verse thinking that it couldn't have been as good as what everybody was saying. I remember when everybody said it was as good as Spider-Man 2. I still don't think it's as good as Spider-Man 2, but it was. Oh, it's always going to be in second place. So when I heard early reviews for this movie coming out and people saying that this movie potentially was better than the first one, I didn't believe any of those reviews neither. Needless to say, in a lot of regards, this movie is actually better than the first one, but in many others, this movie is not better than the first one. I wouldn't even say that it's a masterpiece, but in its own way, it still is a masterpiece. Yes! Number one, you can't talk about this movie without discussing the art style. The art style in the Spider-Verse movies is so iconic and so memorable that even the Ninja Turtles movie that's coming out soon has to emulate the style. But there's truly no other animated movie that's quite like this movie. When I was watching this movie was visually stunning. It's the most stunning comic book movie or animated movie I've ever seen in my life.
Can't stop me now!
You can't run forever, kid!
It plays around with the styles so well that it feels like you're reading a comic book. And when you travel into these other worlds in the multiverse with these Spider-Men, it feels like you're reading those specific versions of the comics. For instance, in Gwen's world, it looks like the Spider-Gwen comic. In Miles' world, it looks like Miles' comic. Everything with Miguel O'Hara has its own unique style. So the art in this movie is a masterpiece. But one thing I can say is that the pacing in this movie definitely feels a lot slower than the first Spider-Verse film. So the pacing in the first movie actually worked way better than this one. I actually felt the runtime a bit more in this movie, and that was going to be hard to manage anyways due to the fact that it's actually twice the runtime. This movie is over 2 hours, and you do feel the runtime a bit more in those slower scenes. However, the movie is so beautiful to look at, and the scenes are so entrancing that it's hard to notice the length sometimes.
Nice.
Also, the movie isn't really quite as coherent and streamlined, which is hard to do when you're managing all these characters in one movie. Whereas the first Spider-Verse movie had a set of characters to focus on, this one has multiple characters, an expansive universe, and a villain to focus on, and it can feel a little bit convoluted and kind of hard to follow sometimes. But what this movie does is it captures the heart of Spider-Man very well once again, much like the first movie. Miles' story is actually not as dominant in this movie. It's very much a Miles Morales story, but this is actually more of a Gwen story in this movie. And those elements I felt like were really deep and the heart of the movie. Miles' scenes were really good too, and I love the expansion of New York that they did.
So are you like a cow or a Dalmatian?
I am the Spot. That's not funny.
Don't do that.
And one character I wasn't expecting to like in this movie was the Spot. He's a very C-tier villain, and to have him be as big of a threat as he was in this was actually surprising. And they acknowledge the fact that he's C-tier multiple times, and it works perfectly within the story that they're trying to tell. You guys will see what I'm talking about. Miguel O'Hara, very good in this movie. I think they nailed him perfectly in this movie. Some of the acts that he commits in this movie can seem a little bit more villainous to some people. However, in the grand scheme of the multiverse, I think they handled him very well. And actually, one thing that I can say about this movie too, without diving into spoilers, is the fact that this movie does No Way Home properly. I'm not saying that No Way Home is a bad movie, I'm just saying that that movie's story wasn't as good as it people think it was. And that's fine, but this movie does No Way Home better than No Way Home does No Way Home.
This isn't what we talked about!
You knew?
I had no idea what you're doing!
Everyone keeps telling me how my story is supposed to go.
Nah, I'm gonna do my own thing.
Also, the music was really good. My favorite theme was actually whenever Miguel would show up on screen, because Miguel actually had the most memorable track. It kind of reminds me of what they did with the Prowler, but they did that with Miguel and it worked very well. Also love the diversity that they had in this movie. We have so many different diverse spider people in here, and the way that they showed diversity in Miles's universe as well, with the Jamaican store owners or the Hispanic family members that he has, or his black dad and his side. Just lots of diversity in this movie. We even have an Indian Spider-Man. Now, I can say that this does not end with end credits at all. It does leave you on a cliffhanger, which is a little bit disappointing, but with a grand story like this, it felt necessary. And this is truly a part one to a phenomenal sequel coming up. Three of the best Spider-Man movies of all time are all made by Sony. And something I noticed with this movie is the fact that this showed me something. I'm not tired of superhero movies. I'm just tired of really bad superhero movies and mediocre superhero movies. And once again, we got another masterclass in the art form. Many of the jokes landed in this movie more than the first movie as well. This movie is actually funnier than the first movie. Comedy actually hit way harder in this one, which was actually an improvement on the writing. Also, the emotional moments hit harder in this one as well, which also speaks again to the writing and the performances of the voice actors and the animators who conveys the emotions of these characters. This truly feels like another masterclass Spider-Man movie, and if you guys have not already seen it, make sure you guys check it out. I'm sorry I didn't dive too much into this movie or some specific details about it, but I can't dive into those details without giving away spoilers. But what I can say is that this movie is made for the fans, by some fans, and if you're a Spider-Man fan, like a hardcore fan, you're gonna notice things in this movie that a lot of other people would probably not even notice. We have so many spider people in there that I can't even notice how many were in that movie.
And I looked at my uncle and...
Let me guess. He died?
One thing I can say is that, for a fact, I can say that this movie is it's a top-tier film. It's not as good as the first Spider-Verse movie, in my opinion. However, I can say that they did a fantastic job in this, and Sony's killing it with the Spider-Man movies. They've been killing it.